It's HPR, All Things Considered, and I'm Dave Lawrence. Rock and Roll Hall of Famer Elvin Bishop, who's got a 50-year history with Hawaii and is back in town. He's playing the Blue Note tonight, tomorrow, with his Big Fun Trio, playing the blues and bluesy rock, going back to his Paul Butterfield Blues Band days. Of course, his humongous hit, Fooled Around and Fell in Love, and if you're lucky enough, maybe he will tell you stories about some of his star-studded jams, places like the Fillmore with Clapton, the Dead, Almonds, lots of others. We welcome him now. Maybe we can get some of those stories out of him ourselves. Hey, Elvin Bishop, thanks for doing this. How are you doing?
Hey, glad to be here. How are you doing?
I'm good, brother. Great to hear your voice. Great to have you with us. And you've had some long history in the islands, huh?
I remember playing Diamond Head Festival. That had to be early 70s, I'd say.
Well, we don't have your first Hawaii dates, but thanks to Steve, the mystery emailer who sends us lots of local history, he has a laundry list of shows of yours going back to 1970, at least, opening for Santana. But the one you recall is the two-day summer Diamond Head Crater Festival, July 3rd and 4th, 77, Journey, Styx, Flash Cadillac, Continental Kids, and Detective.
Well, 77.
Yeah.
The first time I remember being in Hawaii was, there was some club run by a guy from Samoa. It was in the marketplace in
International Marketplace.
Yes.
In the 60s.
It must have been, yeah.
It's great to be able to connect those dots. And similarly, you've got sort of an unusual path that connected you as a young blues fan growing up in Oklahoma to what would be your life passion. You went to the University of Chicago as a National Merit Scholar, full scholarship to study physics.
Right.
But ahead of that, before you got there, and I understand you did that to be closer to the music that you had come to love, as a teenager growing up in Oklahoma, listening to late night radio.
Yeah, this was a long time ago in the 1950s. It was before civil rights, and Oklahoma was kind of sharply segregated in a was not encouraged at all to hang out with people of other races. And the only way the white person was going to hear any blues was on the radio, you know, and I did, and I fell in love with it. And I was lucky to get this scholarship because that was my ticket to Chicago, where I knew blues was happening. My family didn't have any money. I come from a long line of farmers, no rich people, no, and nobody'd ever even been to college in my family, I don't think. You say I studied physics. I didn't so much study it. It's just they make you choose a major. You know? You got to have a major. But I was studying blues when I was studying.
Seems so incongruous, physics. I mean, in what way did you put that down?
Well, I never was a good student, but I was a real good test taker. Fortunately, the University of Chicago is the type of place where you didn't have to go to classes as long as you could pass tests at the end of the semester. And I'd study real hard for a week or so before the test and do all right until I got to calculus. And that's something you got to really put yourself into. And that's where me and school parted ways right there.
Did you ever graduate?
No.
And is it because that's where you met Paul Butterfield and you ended up getting into the thing? Explain how it happened.
Butterfield, I met the first day I was in Chicago. He was just a guy sitting in front of an apartment building playing blues on the guitar and drinking a quart of beer. And I said, hey, this must be my type of guy right here. I better go get to know him. It just went on from there.
And how long after getting there, again, we're talking with Elvin Bishop tonight and tomorrow over at the Blue Note. When I look at your bio, so many names crisscross, and we're talking about that era. You're just in Chicago. You've arrived there for school. You've met Paul. How long after that do you end up getting to jam with Buddy Guy and Otis Rush?
Maybe a year or two. Within a week of getting to Chicago, I'd made friends with some black guys that worked at the university, and they took me down to the ghetto, and I was checking out Muddy Waters, Junior Wells, and Hound Dog Taylor, Howlin' Wolf, Magic Sam, all in their prime.
Explain the evolution to getting from watching it, but then you move on and you start actually getting on stage and playing.
The blues guys, they would get me over their house and show me the ropes, especially a guy named Little Smokey Smothers. I'd just go over and stay in his house for days on end, and he would school me and call in the neighbors. Once we had worked up a tune, he'd teach me the background. He'd play the lead, and just bit by bit, when you're young and on fire 24 hours a day working on it, it
grows.
It comes pretty quick.
Yeah, yeah. Just to clarify, when did you first pick up the guitar?
Maybe 15.
Okay, so prior to coming there, you had a little bit of experience with it, and you brought one with you?
I knew a few chords, but didn't know that much about blues, you know. It's like Bob Seger said, working on mysteries without any clues, you know. You hear the records. I got a hold of the records by then, but it busted out big time when I was able to sit down with guys and see their hands on the guitar and say, oh, wow, this is what's happening, you know, and find out what the words to the blues songs meant when I checked out the lives that went with it, you know.
Yeah, you're talking about that personal time in this cat's house and getting that kind of exposure. That's what you mean.
Right, exactly, yeah.
And this education leads to some surreal interactions. And I guess even more lessons, you could call them, like I was saying in introducing you. Jamming with music luminaries and heroes at places like the different Fillmores and beyond.
I remember in New York playing, not only at the Fillmore, but there were a variety of clubs where you'd go and we had jams with like Hendrix and B.B. King and Clapton and, oh man, just all kinds of stuff going on.
What's a Jimmy memory that comes to mind?
I remember he was a real sweet guy. He was real nice. When it comes to jamming, you know, there's a lot of guys take it as their opportunity to show off. They're kind of egotistical about the whole thing. Jimmy wasn't like that at all. He played nice. He would take turns, you know, and then when somebody else's time to solo, he would back him up. Then when it was his time, he'd step out and just tear up the world. Was a cool guy.
It's nice how you talk about him because it sounds like these are lessons you pick up yourself.
Yeah. I learned a lot from B.B. King, especially about that kind of thing. I always thought that if the Martians landed, we should send B.B. to talk to him, you know. I'd been listening to his records forever, but I think I met him in maybe the late 60s. And the first thing he did, he invited me up to his hotel room in San Francisco. And here was this guy who was just generally acknowledged to be the number one guy in the blues world, which was the world to me, you know. And I went to his hotel room, and he's in his dressing gown, and he's got sheet music spread all over his bed, and he's just working like a dog on scales and practicing, you know. And I thought, wow, this guy is in the position he's in, and he's just in the habit of improving himself all the time. This is a real good lesson.
Wow. Do you ever get a chance to find yourself on stage jamming with some of the cats from, you know, your yesteryear, and you just think, oh my God, look at us, we're back together again?
Every once in a while, not this time, but the time before we were at the Summerfest, we got to jam with the Doobie Brothers. That was fun. And I think one of the guys lives on Maui.
Of course, Patrick Simmons.
I know Pat Simmons pretty well. I've been to his place.
On Maui?
Yeah. I'll tell you something. You know Willie Kay, right?
Yep.
When I met him, he must have weighed about 150 pounds.
And you're using that by comparison, I guess.
Yes, there you go. And I met him in the 70s. He's always had that great voice.
You have a real Hawaii connection. You didn't throw that thing out. So what other Hawaii connections are you holding back on me over there, Mr. Bishop, that we...
George Kahamoku.
You know him too.
Yeah, he's a cool guy, yeah. I've jammed with him a few times. I've gone to his gigs and stuff and gone to his hula. He was at some kind of hula school deal. And I went over, he's a professor. He teaches at the university in Kahului. I went over to his class. He wanted me to speak to his class. And this kid asked me, he said, well, what's the difference between rock and blues? And for some reason, I just kind of blurted out, well, rock is weed, blues is hash.
That's a good Hawaii kind of answer, huh?
It went over pretty good, I think.
It's a great Elvin Bishop. He is tonight and tomorrow, two shows a night, 6:30 and 9, Rock and Roll Hall of Fame member. It's great talking to you. I hope you had fun today. I really enjoyed getting to talk with you, Elvin.
Back at you, man. Back at you. I appreciate it.